Good morning. Welcome everyone on Zoom. Welcome everybody in person. I'm going to ring the bell to officially start our morning meeting. All right. Welcome to Rotary, everyone in person, if you could stand. I'd like to welcome everybody to the Rotary Club of Maplewood, North St. Paul, and Oakdale. I'm going to ask Mo on our Zoom. Mo, would you start us off in our Pledge of Allegiance?
Your sound is breaking up, so I can't really hear you.
Mo and I are going to together start the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge of allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America.
One nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Miss Sylvia, welcome back. Great to see you.
Thank you.
Start us off in the five-way test.
Okay, the five-way test of the things we think, say, and do. Number one, is it the truth? Number two, is it fair to all concerned? Number three, will it build goodwill and better friends? Number four, will it be beneficial to all concerned? And most important, number five, is it fun?
Great. Thank you, Sylvia. Is it fun? All right. We're going to wait for our greeter. Hold on. Pause.
Do you have some words of encouragement or invocations on you?
Okay. As we gather here today as members of Rotary, we pray that we are ever mindful of opportunities to render our services to fellow citizens into our community, keeping in mind always the enduring values of life, exerting our efforts in those areas and on those things upon which future generations can build with confidence. Let us continue to strive to make a better world. And I just want to add, since it's Good Friday today, maybe if we could just say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Terry. All right, I'm going to welcome up our Sergeant of Arms for today. It might just be you, Mr. Randy.
I think it's me.
Oh, all right, well, I'll help with some microphones.
Good morning, Zoomers. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Good morning.
Happy summer. Glad you all could join for a beautiful summer day today. I said that to a handful of kids yesterday as they were coming into school, and they looked at me like I had one big eye in the middle of my forehead. Like, are you okay? Like, summer somewhere, just not here. Since I'm guessing we can write it down later as well.
Yeah.
There. So it looks like we have our speaker today, our guest, Laurel. Can you hear us okay? So we'll do an introduction maybe as you get closer to your time during this morning. But during this part of the morning, we do announcements. We do any things that people want to share. We do something called Happy Bucks, which are contributions people want to make toward an announcement or with an announcement, and goes toward our North St. Paul food shelf. Those on Zoom can be able to join in with Happy Bucks as well. In fact, I see a hand up from Sylvia. Is that a hand raised in particular?
Yeah, for a Happy Buck, you better believe it. First place, so I'm so glad to be here this morning. I thought I wouldn't be able to. I did sort of a tripped over a rug in my house, which was not fun, and ended up having to go to the hospital and have 30 stitches. And I broke a rib, and I'm just so happy to be here. However, on the other side of the coin, my daughter's coming over shortly to tell me what I can and can't do. So I'm going to put in $10 because I'm going to need all the strength I can get to just agree with her until she goes away. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
By the way, Randy, you asked where summer is. It's here. My daffodils have already bloomed and are going away. And I'm looking behind Mo and I see snow.
Yeah.
Did it snow yesterday?
Yep.
Maybe.
Oh.
You don't want to give in and give into that kind of, you know, one-upsmanship. But yeah, maybe it snowed here and not where you are.
It's not meant to be one-upsmanship. I'm just so grateful to see green. Anyway, and great to see you. Great to see all of you.
And just to put it out there, I'll be bringing food next week, and y'all can just lower the bar right now with that hot dish. Yeah, look away. There's really nothing to observe. I will start us off with an in-person happy buck. With actually, I have two. One, I want to say thanks to whoever brought the Twins tickets last week. I think it might have been a group, right?
Noemi. So Noemi.
My wife, Lisa, and I were able to go, although we didn't get there till the second inning because it was a 3:10 start, and working in a school is not exactly easy to get out of at that time of day, but did see Noemi and Rochelle at the game, and also midway through, we went looking for cheese curds and found some, but it was also indoors at that point inside one of the places, so we stayed there and watched the end of the game from there, but it was a great time to be able to go. And then a second happy buck going out for we have tickets tomorrow night to see Prom at the Orpheum Theater. So, well reviewed. I know nothing about it other than my wife said the review in the Star Tribune said it was excellent. And don't do the movie version on Netflix, but actually see it in person. So that's really good, apparently. I know nothing about it, but I'm going to see it tomorrow. And maybe next week I'll give you a report. So I have a couple of dollars to go into Happy Bucks for that. Who in person has something else to share? Brian.
I do. Make sure I'm holding it like an ice cream cone. Sylvia, I want to tell you this morning it was 28 degrees. And I have a happy buck because today is the first day of lacrosse season. Grandpa and grandma will be there. We will be there with long underwear, double socks, parkas, whatever it takes to stay warm. And so I have a happy buck for the start of the lacrosse season.
Yeah. And according to my weather app here says it's 21, but actually feels like 7. Yeah. Single digit.
Listen, the wind was so bad yesterday, you put a lacrosse ball in the air, it probably would have blown off the field. Right.
Good luck being a goalie on that day.
Yeah.
Who else has something to share?
All I can say is we've got to be happy that we're here and not in Bismarck, North Dakota. My sister-in-law sent me pictures. She said it has not stopped snowing for like 2 days. And the drifts were so high, I could not believe it. It was just unreal. All the interstates closed pretty much from Montana to Jamestown. All roads going up north in the central part. So everything is closed. But I said, do you have wine? And she said, oh, yeah, we're stocked.
It is kind of saying something when you think about like people could move here for the better weather.
Good morning, everybody. So yesterday my wife and I put in a offer to buy a parcel of land in Richmond. We're hoping to hear back today. At the same time, we are heading out to see her brother in Spokane to attempt to get out of this weather. If we remember my speech last week, big into motorcycle riding, and he has about 6 in his garage.
Wow.
Ready to go. So we're, fingers crossed, going to be able to ride some motorcycles this weekend as well.
Oh, fun.
Fingers crossed indeed.
Any other happy bucks?
Rochelle made it.
But the reason is because I drove my son to Faribault this morning at 5:30, and he's off to Indiana, to Shattuck St. Mary's. Yeah. So Indiana for this weekend, which I'm super bummed because it's not going to be around for Easter, but it's like, all right, run, drive. So I'm just happy I didn't get a ticket.
Yeah. How are the roads? Yeah. Bad. Not good.
A happy bug for not getting a speeding violation. Yeah. That's worth it.
That's a good one. All right. Anything else? Anyone on Zoom?
Anyone else? Yeah. On Zoom. Want to chime in or share? Have been doing okay? All right. I turn it back over to present.
There we go. All right. For some announcements, we do have a board meeting next Tuesday. So please, please, please get your agenda items to April. We do not want to go into that board meeting with an empty agenda. So please get them to her this weekend so she can send them out. Thank you to Terry for being a greeter, Carolyn for bringing a lovely breakfast. And a reminder, Brian, you are Meals on Wheels. Never mind. Not today. It's Good Friday. No Meals on Wheels. But next week, Brian is greeter. We're getting there. Yes. All right. We are going to do a long overdue thing. We're actually going to ask Rochelle to step into the hallway where she cannot hear us. Dun, dun, dun. So we should have done this 7 minutes ago. What was that? Oh, I'm like, did I miss it? All right, we are going to do our voting for our next two presidents coming up here. So we're going to be voting separately. We'll vote for Rochelle first, who will be president in the 2023-2024 year, and then Isaac in the 2024-2025 year. Right? It feels so far away. All right. So we're going to first do a vote for Rochelle to be president in the 2023-2024 year. All in favor, raise your hand or say aye. Any opposed? Fabulous. Rochelle will be our president. And then for Isaac for the 2024-25 year, all in favor, raise your hand or say aye. Any opposed? Fabulous. All right. I'm going to welcome her back. We're going to clap and be all excited. All right. Woo! We are happy to announce that Rochelle has been accepted as our president-elect nominee for the 2023-2024 Rotary Year. Congratulations. We're so excited to have you.
Unanimous.
Unanimous voting.
All of your experiences.
Yes. We have a wealth of knowledge.
It was unanimous and everyone voted for you.
And if I can do it, you can do it. All right. Let's see. Any other announcements anyone would like to make? Going once, going to what? Oh. Wait, you need a mic.
I sent out an email yesterday afternoon. I hope that everybody read it, except for you. Oh, thank you. And just want to remind you, in 2 weeks, we will be having a little celebration for Kristen here. So anyway, 2 weeks from now, make sure that you do what you're supposed to be doing. Okay. Thanks.
All right. Our one Rotary anniversary, Joel Stallman, who is not here today because he's on a work trip, has been in Rotary for 8 years. So fun one for him. Joel Stallman, 8 years in Rotary. The little guy. Glad that wasn't on the microphone. Okay. We have our speaker. Laurel, we're super excited to have you here. We're going to have you introduce yourself, both personally and professionally. And we're super excited for your program today on literacy. So take it away. You're on mute.
All right. There we go. Now we'll try. So thank you so much for having me. My name is Laurel. I'm a volunteer with Amarok Society. And so for them, I help create content, do writing for the website and social media, and I talk to Rotary clubs like yours. So I'm going to try and share my screen. There we go. Make this big. Perfect. All right. So the best way for me to tell you about Amarok is to tell you a little bit about this boy. This is Fahim. Fahim is 11 years old and he lives in Dhaka, the capital city of Bangladesh. Dhaka is a city of about 20 million people. It's the fastest growing megacity on Earth. It is predicted that over the next 30 years, virtually all of the world's population growth will take place in major urban centers, particularly in the booming slums of megacities like Dhaka. So Fahim's experience of life is becoming more and more common in the world. If Fahim could go to school, he would go to the small school on the edge of his slum. School in Bangladesh is free. However, there are certain costs associated with it. Costs such as school uniforms, school supplies, textbooks, that sort of thing. And although these costs are small, they are prohibitively expensive for someone as destitute as Fahim. However, if Fahim's parents did manage to scrape together enough money to send him to school, he would walk into a sweltering little room on the first day of class to find himself sitting next to 60 or 70 other children. Bangladesh has the worst student-to-teacher contact ratio on Earth. So we'd be getting none of his teacher's attention, and she'd only be using rote learning anyway. Now, rote learning is when the teacher stands at the front of the class and she says A, B, C, and the students call back A, B, C, and she says it again, A, B, C, and the students reply, A, B, C, and this goes on and on and on, and somewhere along the way, literacy is supposed to happen. Fahim would be facing another obstacle with his teacher, in that she would be underpaid by the government and would resort to shadow education. And shadow education is a problem throughout the developing world. What it is the practice of teachers who make less than a living wage, closing down their classes early, and selling their services as private tutors. What that means for Fahim is that he can attend school every day. He can work hard and be studious, but he's only getting half a lesson. So if he actually wants to pass any of the exams, if he actually wants to get into the next grade, maybe even go to high school, he needs to be able to hire a private tutor. And of course, his family can't afford that either. He'd also be facing another obstacle at home, which is that Fahim's parents, like Fahim, grew up destitute and uneducated. So they don't understand how education works. They don't see it as a long-term investment. So after springing for school supplies and failing to see the immediate acquisition on Fahim's part of suddenly employable skills, they're likely to get frustrated after a year or two and pull him out of school. But none of that matters, because even if Fahim's school really was free, even if his teachers had the skills and resources to teach, and even if his family could help him on his educational journey, Fahim can't go to school. Fahim needs to be working to support his family, which he does. Fahim works at what you might call an auto repair shop, but it's sort of a shop as it is a corrugated lean-to by the side of the road. Fahim's days are spent helping to change tires, loosening and tightening bolts, small menial manual tasks. And as far as child labor goes, it's not that bad, which is quite a thing to say. But there are worse things Fahim could be doing. He could be breaking bricks. He could be out begging. He could be working in a sweatshop. There are worse ways that a city like Dhaka could employ a boy like Fahim. But this job does have the destructive effect of preventing him from going to school. When Amarok Society's founders, Dr. Tanis and Jen Monroe, moved to Dhaka 18 years ago, they saw an awful lot of children like Fahim, little boys and girls in the slums who should have been in school but weren't, or who were in school but were getting nothing out of it. Having had a great deal of opportunity to look into this problem since, we have unfortunately discovered that this isn't a Bangladesh problem. This is a world problem. The world is facing an education crisis. What I mean by that is that right now, of all the children in the world, more than 1 in 3 are growing up illiterate. More than 250 million children of the 650 million children alive today are growing up locked out of access to a quality education, and consequently locked into lives of poverty, exploitation, and violence. Now, it seems intuitive, doesn't it? We've got hundreds of millions of children who are out of school or who are in school but are getting nothing out of it. We need to build more schools. We need to build better schools. And that process of building a school, bringing in teachers, training the teachers, bringing in children, teaching the children, and sending them on their merry way is the first thing anyone would think of. It comes naturally to us because that's what gave us our education. However, we keep trying it and we keep trying it and we keep getting the same result, which is that this model is failing to make education truly accessible in the developing world. And the reason for this is that this model isn't responsive to all of the marginalizing factors at play in so many children's lives. Fahim, for instance, could be scrabbling through a labyrinth of free schools on his way to work every day, and it wouldn't do him the slightest bit of good. So what we struck upon was the idea of going into slums and teaching mothers in the slums to become neighborhood teachers. So each mother we teach pays for her education by teaching at least 5 children in the community what she's learning. And this model of going into the poorest, most dangerous slums in Muslim cities, of proposing to teach people's wives and people's daughters, of elevating their status within the community to that of teacher, has been a challenge. It's been met with a lot of opposition. But thanks to the courage and dedication of these women, it's also been a real success. This model is truly sustainable. And I don't just mean in the monetary sense, although it is very cost effective to teach one person to teach 5 others. But what I mean by this is that by teaching a mother to teach her children, you're creating a culture of education from within the family. And if you want to create a culture of education in these places, you do it through the mothers. Now, because women are the crux of Amarok Society, because their successes and their strengths are our successes and our strengths, and because mothers are what make our model unique, it is tempting to spend the rest of this time just speaking to the successes of our mothers. They are leaders in their communities. They are beacons. They are champions of women's rights, children's rights, peace, tolerance, and education. They are making these slums better and safer places in which to live and in which to grow up. But the purpose of all of this is to reach children. So I'm going to keep talking about children for a little bit. Now, for all the things Fahim has going against him, being a destitute boy in a city that makes no room for destitute little boys, At least he isn't a little girl. This is Adiri. Adiri is 8 years old and she lives in Kalna, Bangladesh's second largest city. I can tell you a little bit about what Adiri's life might have been by telling you about what her mother's life has been. Adiri's mother's name is Hamaya. Hamaya had the all too common experience of being married at the age of 11 or 12 to a grown man. We aren't sure her exact age because neither Hamaya nor her parents could count at the time. Bangladesh suffers under the crippling weight of a terribly destructive dowry system. The way that the dowry system works is that in Bangladesh, the bride's family pays the groom's family a dowry. But there's a catch. The older the bride, the higher the dowry. So for the poorest of the poor, for the people who must make every penny count, there is a very strong incentive to marry their daughters off at a very young age. So because of that, in these slums, it is entirely common for a girl to be married by the age of 13, and almost exceptional for her to make it to 18 without being married. So Hamaya began her life as a wife. She was expected to do all the cooking and all the cleaning for her new husband and his little child. And she was also expected to start having babies, which she did. Now, Adiri is lucky. We did open a school in her slum. So every day, Hamaya attends our school, and then she goes home, and she teaches Adiri, Adiri's brothers, and some of Adiri's neighbors. Now, Adiri is doing something really interesting with this education. Every day, after her lesson with Hamaya, she sits in the doorway of her little shack, and she teaches her friends what she's learning. Now, her little lessons are formal things. It's the same few children at the same time every day. And this is actually something we've seen a lot of. The children we teach are so excited by the education they're getting that they want to teach their friends what they're learning. And so far, the ratio is that for every child we teach, each child teaches about one other child. So we open a school. The school is 25 mothers. We train them as teachers. They each teach at least 5 children. And for each of those children, there's about one other child who is also receiving that education. We call it our benevolent pyramid scheme. So one day, Adiri's grandfather took notice of this. And he said, Adiri, you're learning to read, write, and do arithmetic. And you're teaching these children to read, write, and do arithmetic. And yet your own grandfather knows none of this. Will you teach me? And Adiri said, yes, grandfather, I will. So now, if you know the right slum to go to, you can see the very encouraging sight of an old man sitting down and learning from his granddaughter. And 15 years ago, it would have been perfectly reasonable for you to predict that none of these men would ever admit they had anything to learn from a woman, let alone a little girl. Consider this man's journey. He's gone from seeing women and girls as being appropriately expendable to sitting down and receiving an education from an 8-year-old, as provided to her by his own daughter. And this is quite a long way to come. And what's more encouraging is that we don't have to keep reinventing this wheel. All the little boys that Adiri teaches, all the little boys that she learns beside, all the boys in all our schools will grow up believing it is completely natural and completely desirable for a woman to be educated. And Adiri is obviously a very bright and compassionate little girl. She's taking the small piece of education she's received and is using it to make the world a better place. And if I had to really boil down what an education is, I would say that an education is the process of giving the world to a child. You are giving their life to them, so that a jury's life might actually belong to a jury. It doesn't have to belong to some randomly selected older man, or a garment factory sweatshop owner, or the confines and predictable patterns of her poverty. A jury's life can belong to her, for her to decide and direct. But there's a flip side. When you educate a child, you're not only giving the world to that child, you're also giving that child to the world. And this world needs that child. We need a jury to grow up from being a bright, spirited, kind-hearted little girl to becoming an intelligent, brave, compassionate woman. She's already taken this little bit of education and is using it to lift up the world, the people around her. Imagine what she can do when she's in university or pursuing a professional career. The things that she'll be able to contribute to the world that would never have been possible if she'd been forced into a life of destitute illiteracy. Now, I talked about child marriage, so I feel it's only fair to tell you about how that situation has changed in the slums where we're working. Now, I need to clarify that this isn't something Amarok Society is doing. This is something Amarok Society mothers are doing. When these women first set foot in one of our tiny classrooms, that step they take through the doorway is the bravest step they may take in their life. These women have grown up being told, sometimes violently, that education is not for them, that it's wrong for them to learn, that they're not smart enough to be educated anyway, that they're upsetting the social fabric by merely stepping into a classroom. And they do it anyway, because they know that it is the only shot their children will ever have at an education. And what happens then is incredible. These women help each other and support each other as they challenge everything they've ever known about the world and their place in it. It's truly transformational. When we open a school, our goal is to create 25 teachers. But what always ends up happening is that what we've created are 25 sisters, 25 friends, a group of women who have all experienced this incredible transformation together and found that when they support each other, they have real power. They can make a difference to the world. So what they started to do is ask themselves, well, if we can challenge everything we've ever known about the world, if we can make changes to it, then what would we like to change? What matters to us? And one of the things they've decided is that they have had it with the dowry system. They have had it with seeing their children get married off to strangers, all to perpetuate the same cycle of trauma and abuse that they and their mothers all endured. So these women have banded together for a dowry strike. Not a single one of them will pay or accept a dowry, and none of them will marry their children off. In fact, whenever they hear about a wedding being arranged in the community, they go to the parents and they speak with them, reason with them, explain why child marriage is harmful to the child, the nation, and the community. The result of all of this is that these women have eradicated child marriage in each of the communities where we operate a school. And like I said, this isn't something we told them to do. This was all their idea, their enterprise. The closest we can come to taking credit is simply to say that this is the sort of thing that happens when you give women an education. Now, I'd like to touch on Fahim again briefly, not to talk about who he is, but about who he could be. And the question is this: what happens if we leave him alone? What happens if we don't do anything? He'll grow up hungry, desperate, frustrated, appropriately angry, perhaps, and feeling as if his life has no purpose. And a sense of purpose is a cruel thing of which to starve a person. I wish I could say we had competition from other well-meaning NGOs in these slums to reach a boy like Fahim, but as far as I can see, we don't. But we do have competition in reaching him. there is the person who sees an opportunity in that. In a boy growing into a young man who feels disempowered, disenfranchised, and disconnected from society. Who feels alone and as though his life doesn't belong to him, that there is no hope, there's a person who looks at that and sees an opportunity and says, aha, now there's something. And our competition is coming from the madrasas. Extremism is blossoming in Bangladesh, as it is throughout much of the developing world. Our failure to provide universal education has provided one third of the world's upcoming population, more than 250 million children with whom to play. We can't mow extremism down with a machine gun. We can't shoot it. We can't drop bombs on it. We can't set it on fire. It won't die that way. It revels in death. It feeds on destruction and war. So long as there are millions of people ignorant enough to swallow any rhetoric and desperate enough to carry out any deed, we cannot defeat it. But there is one thing the extremist fears. It's her. An educated, reasoning mind that has learned to love the world. Because there is nothing he can do with her, and there is nothing he can do with any of the children she teaches. They are immune. Once we give her a reason to live, and once she gives her students a reason to live, he has no opportunity by which to provide them with a reason to die. Peace and prosperity will follow education. And with the courage and dedication of mothers everywhere, and the strength and support of Rotary, a universally educated world is within our grasp. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we're going to open it up to questions. Brian.
Oh, I do have one. So maybe I missed it, but what is your connection to Rotary?
So Rotary is our biggest supporter. We receive most of our funding from Rotary, and we partner with Rotary clubs in Bangladesh to deliver this program to the communities that they're stationed in.
How many Rotary clubs do you work with in Bangladesh?
I'm not sure the answer to that question, actually, but I can find that out for you. I know there are quite a few.
Great. And where are you located?
So I'm in Regina. Amarok is based out of Canada, but we're sort of spread across the country in our various roles.
We're all discussing where exactly on the map you are.
Oh, Saskatchewan.
Thank you. So what kind of support are you looking for? What is that? What are things that we can help get connected with? And what would you suggest?
So, of course, always funding, but additionally just spreading the word, so talking to other Rotary clubs, letting them know about us. In the past, speaking at district conferences has been a really helpful, impactful thing for us. So those are the things you can do.
May I ask a question? Are you a club? Am I muted?
Nope, you're good.
It's hard to mute me. Are you a 501c3 or an NGO over there?
So we are a registered charitable organization. I'm not sure what the 501c3 status is.
Well, that's the American 501c3 is the standard nonprofit. That's why I'm asking, because you said you're in Canada. So
that's right.
I don't know if you're in the United States registered, or if you are in Bangladesh, if you're registered as an NGO. An NGO is a non-governmental organization, and that's usually.
Yes, yes, we are registered as an NGO, yep.
Do you get any government funding?
We do sometimes get government funding from Canadian government, but that funding is transient.
It's just because they're more amenable to an NGO than if you're coming in, you know.
Yeah.
A couple questions we have. How did you get involved, and maybe how did you find out about this club, and are there others that you speak with as well?
Sure. So I got involved with the organization. I met my partner in 2019, and he's their director of communications, and I, you know, heard about what they were doing and I wanted to help. So that's how I got involved. As for speaking to other Rotary clubs, I've done 3 this week. I do several over Zoom on a very regular basis. All over. So right now we're working our way through Illinois and Minnesota. We kind of just move across the map.
You must be really good at figuring out time zones.
Yeah. I mean, where I am, the time zone doesn't change. So there's always a bit of a calculation as the world changes around us.
Yes.
I just finished reading the book, The Girl with the Louding Voice. Have you read that? By Abby?
Not.
Very similar. The education for girls and girls getting married off at a very young age, and also not prohibited from. I mean, what you said, you could have read the book and gone right through the whole thing, but it was very interesting and very sad. But good for those. The Girl with the Louding Voice by Abby Dari. Yep.
Thank you. I'm going to write that down.
She mentioned the book that she read takes place in Nigeria.
Yes. We did previously operate a school in Nigeria for the same reason that, you know, there is a similar situation as what's going on in Bangladesh.
You guys have a website?
We do. It's
Give us the address.
It's amaroksociety.org, and that's spelled AMAROK.
How do you choose where all the schools are going to be located?
So we started our first school in Bangladesh, and we opened a couple, and then from there, basically in slums, the communities where we work are now all by invitation. So even though at first we faced a lot of opposition in opening these schools, eventually it became a very desirable thing for these communities for us to come work there. So the way we basically choose where we're going to operate a school are 2 things. So it's based on need, what's the situation, does it make sense, and also whether we've been invited to work there.
You mentioned of course, Bangladesh and then Nigeria. Are there other countries as well that the organization's involved in, and did Nigeria continue or not continue?
We discontinued working in Nigeria. I'm not sure specifically the reasons for that. I think there were certain challenges with working there. And we previously worked in Pakistan. We unfortunately had to close that school due to a lack of funding, but we would like to see our organization basically expand to wherever there is the need for this kind of programming, which there are in a lot of places in the world.
Sure.
What does the staffing structure of the organization look like? It sounds like it's a lot of volunteers, and how does that work?
Yeah, so basically, our staff in Canada was all volunteer. And we've got staff in Bangladesh that's paid, and they help us to basically train the teachers and to deliver the programming there.
Other questions? All right. Well, thank you so much for your time today in presenting this information. Very educational for us. So thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.
All right. Does anyone have any other announcements?
Just one quick thing. April had reached out to me earlier in the month just to confirm as we move to next year, people in various roles that they are serving in at this point in time for overseeing different aspects of Rotary to ask if, and hopefully the answer is yes, that those are continuing into, those that are in those roles are continuing into next year as well. I'll send out an email to the club just to confirm those that are in various leadership roles within committee structures within the club will stay in those.
I think we've got a few minutes. Sylvia sent out an email this last week, I think, talking about a fundraiser for her program. Can you just give us a little bit more information on that, Sylvia?
Oh, sure. You mean the announcement of those two awards?
Yes, and then there was one also about buying a cow and some chickens and something else.
Oh, okay, yes. Hey, you know, I'm big into livestock. First is, I did send you, because I got two surprise awards I hadn't expected. One is Best Advertising Agency in Holmdel, which, you know, 17,000 people. But the one that was so wonderful was from an international recognition out of England, Best Media Practices and Outstanding Salesperson or something like that. Yeah, there's a young lady in... at Red Bank Catholic, 16 years old. Her name, I have to spell you her last name because her name's Veronica, and then that's B-A-K-S-H-T. Now that's Bakht because she's Russian. But of course, the first time you see it, you think, oh my God, my name's Veronica Bakht. And I thought the poor kid, you know, she's got to change. But she came to me and she said, I'm a junior this year. I have a 4.9 GPA and I'm president of the Honor Society, and I'm the head of the, you know, and she's a little itty bitty size one with that gorgeous Russian skin. And she said, I'd like to raise money for your Sylvia's children. Okay. Now, part of it is I'm letting her run with it. She ran into some roadblocks and I said, that's what happens when you do this. But she put together, she wants to help us build the model farm, which would then be, again, another revenue generator. And we need 2 cows, 5 goats, and 50 rabbits. I know, I'm into livestock. She did do a GoFundMe site, which I can have sent out again to everybody. She has raised about $1,000 because she's got $550 on that site and then some other. Also, in the private Catholic schools, they do dress down days and they pay the right to come in jeans. She said if she can get she's trying to raise $13,500. She says if she can get 3 dress down days, she'll raise all that money. Wow. They must pay a fortune just to dress down. But here's what's cute too. I got an email from Sophia. Sophia's 13, cute little round cheeks, round face, and she wants to raise money because it's part of her bat mitzvah that she has to do. And she is going to raise $3,600 to pay for 10 children's tuition in a year. I think both of those young people, I mean, they brought tears to my eyes. I didn't know who they were. They came to me just out of the blue, and they're raising money for me. So thank you for asking.
Sylvia, how did they find you? If you didn't know them.
I'm under a rock. They're sylviaschildren.org. I also, obviously, I crank out, you saw, I mean, I crank out the PR. I've just got another story getting that'll be next month talking about come June 3rd of this year, I will have done this for 19 years. So I'll be starting my 20th year. Well, you got to do a 20th year PR, right? And I've raised over $2 million by myself. Now, when I see, by myself with a big mouth, right? And lots of you have helped, which is so wonderful. But to me, it's exciting.
So we're going to have a name the rabbit opportunity here coming up.
not yet, but I will keep, I'll keep you in the loop. You can't get rid of me. And Randy, I'll continue to do PR for the group. You know that.
Thank you, Sylvia. Now, if somebody doesn't buy a rabbit, does that make it a bad hair day?
You've been with kids too long.
That one might cost you $1 next week.
But thank you for asking.
Great. Any other announcements? All right. Well, with that, we welcome everybody to hang around, visit with each other. Laurel, thank you so much for presenting and sharing this information with us today. With that, our meeting is adjourned, and have a fabulous weekend.
Happy Easter, everybody.
Happy Easter.